like Magnus said, there are several people that contributed, but I put Sigurlaug here because some of the work on Eyjafjallajökull is actually what she did. So, but there are other people. So the outline of the talk, I'll go over some things, the intrusion period that we recorded in Eyjafjallajökull and also the eruption, and we see different examples of eruptions and signals from those. Katla, both the deep and the shallow seismicity, it'd be a short one. And then Bárðarbunga, the horizontal dike propagation to the eruption site, and the vertical magma ascension from the deep crust. So here is Iceland, the rift zones, the rift crosses Iceland along them. Here are the volcanoes, the red triangles. And these are the volcanoes that have erupted in the last 50 years. And here is the seismic network as it is today. And the volcanoes I'll talk about is Eyjafjallajökull here and Katla, and then Bárðarbunga here in Vatnajökull. And we've improved a lot the network around Katla in the last few years. And during futurevolc, we tremendously improved the sensitivity to volcanic activity in the Vatnajökull glacier. So here's this guy, Eyjafjallajökull 2010. That caused havoc in Europe for several weeks. It's located, like I said, here in the southern part of the Eastern Rift Zone. And from 1991, here you see I'm plotting the cumulative number of earthquakes recorded on our system from when it was started in 1991 until end of 2009. And you can see that there are about 800 earthquakes recorded, and we have these episodes of much increased activity, and that is during intrusion episodes into the crust. In 94 and 99, there were shallow intrusions, and in 96, it was a deep intrusion at the base of the crust. They were mostly mapped in this region here, and also here along the western rim. If in the next figure that comes here is the vertical cross section, so we're looking through in depth through the crust and seeing how these events are distributed in depth, and we see this cluster here, which is the intrusions in 94 and 99, and then this deep one here, which was generated in 1996. And we can clean this up a little bit by only leaving the best located events, and we can see that the location of the intrusion, or at least most of the events, were here northeast of the crater, and they formed like this horseshoe pattern that completely overlapped in these two periods. And here is the deep cluster. The actual sill that was intruded was a little bit farther south. But then here we see increasing activity in 2009, and that's again plotted here. We're going here from February 2009 until October 2010. And the blue curve, the red curve shows the number of earthquakes, similar to here. And whereas we were recording 800 events here, the total number of earthquakes in the event went up to almost 4,000. So it was a much bigger event. The earthquake size magnitudes were similar, sort of between 1 and 2, but they went up to about 3.5 in magnitude. Here is an example from the intrusion in 2010. And remember, here was this vertical space, and the intrusion was there. Now it is a little bit farther east. This is the top crater, I forgot to tell you that. Most of the activity during January, February, and March was here along this eastern-western sort of sausage-like dike. And then in the middle of March, it started propagating upwards. In the last day of before the eruption, there was an eruption that started here on the flank of Fimvörðuháls in the late evening of the 20th of March. During that day, the earthquakes actually moved towards the surface. We were not really, back then, so aware of this shallowing, and also our location techniques were not so great back then. But this event ended up in a small fissure eruption on Fimvörðuháls, a few hundred meters long. It wasn't very loud. Here I am also plotting again the, not again, first time, seismogram from a station that's a little bit east of here. It's on Goðaland, and we call it God. It's 8 kilometers from the site, and it's seismogram from 9 in the evening until midnight. And here is the amplitude as a function of frequency. So this goes from frequencies of 0.5 hertz up to 6 hertz. And the amplitude is colored so that the most energetic ones are red and up to purple, and the weaker ones go down into green and blue. So background is the blue. The strongest noise at this time is the noise from the oceans, and that would completely dwarf these amplitudes. So we only look above 0.5 hertz because the noise, the ocean is below that. But we can see here just after 10 o'clock, the amplitude at higher frequencies starts to grow, and we start seeing these overtones. And that is most likely the onset of the eruption. Just to remind you, this flank eruption was a very small one, but the main eruption that caused the problems was the one that came out of the top crater. I'll go back to this later, but just to show you that it started out of the western part of this dike here at around 10 kilometers or so, and went up into the crust and up to the surface. But let's stay with this dike eruption. It went on from the 20th of March until I think 12th of April, and it was a real tourist attraction. I went there also, like all the other tourists, to look at these beautiful lava falls that were melting ice and rumbling in these gorges here. But during the day, we started noticing the steam here, and we paid no attention to that. But that was a new fissure that was opening beside the other one. And it opened up, there were people running around there, so we know exactly when it opened, around 5 o'clock. But here, I'm showing this seismogram, and the tremor signal. Here is the noise from the ocean. Now we can go all the way down to zero and up to 6 hertz, because the signal from this melting and boiling is big enough so that we can see it, even though that the microseismic noise is there. But we cannot see the opening of the second eruption because the noise is already too high, we can't see it. And then in the evening, here is the first fissure and the other one here behind. So the onset of the Eyjafjallajökull top crater eruption, remember, it started here in the late hours, at 11 o'clock in the evening on the 13th of April, and it propagated all the way to the surface in a matter of hours. And here's the map for site. I don't know why I put it there. Anyway, again, we have the seismogram from the station God, which is here, and it goes from 9 in the evening on the 13th until 9 in the evening on the following day. And I'm plotting frequencies from 0 up to 10 hertz. Now the energy in this event is strong enough so that I don't have to block out the microseismic noise. I can see here this swarm that starts at 11 in the evening, but then it stopped around midnight, and then around 1 o'clock this amplitude here started growing. And then around 9 the eruption came out of the glacier. This thing was confusing us for a bit. This is an earthquake in Japan, but the magma was probably on the surface around 1:15. So when magma is on the surface interacting with water, we start seeing tremor like this. There's also important aspects that we recorded during this event. We were recording these deep events. There had been a very strong tremor sequence with no plume activity that was generated by the lava interacting with the ice, I think. But then that suddenly died down, and the day after we started recording these events in the beginning of May, 3rd and 4th of May, and they went all the way down to 22 kilometers, so all the way down to the bottom of the crust. And they were moving up and down this very narrow channel. That day, the OMI satellite did not show any significant output from the volcano, but the following day, around 2 o'clock, there's this strong SO2 signal going out of the volcano and heading to our friends in the UK. And there's no ash at that time. The MODIS doesn't show anything. But the second day, then the ash has arrived. And there's this joke that the Brits asked us for cash, but we sent them all this ash and gas. I don't think they appreciated it. So we can see in this eruption that deep seismicity precedes SO2 output and ash also by a significant amount of time. So this is something we should look into for monitoring. Katla, just for short, it's the neighbor of Eyjafjallajökull, and remember we were recording this deep cluster and also a middle cluster. Yes, here's the deep cluster. So I was wondering, can we see this also in Katla? And Katla has this big caldera, this is what it looks like when I look at the better located events. 80% are located in the top 3 kilometers, but there's this small cluster here underneath the eastern rim. And we've added more stations, and we are picking up more of this seismicity, and there's also a cluster here. So in the next few years, I hope we can have some more structure to how the magma flows in there and how much it is. But the shallow activity is approximately correlating with the locations of cauldrons. You probably will not see them, but it is shallow, and it seems to cluster near to or at cauldrons. So meaning that it represents geothermal activity. So here is Bárðarbunga, its activity over the preceding years of the eruption, the 10 years. The activity was located to the northeast of the caldera rim, which is shown here. And also this cluster of deep seismicity, which we will talk about, had already started. But at the beginning of this event on 16th of August, the activity started here in the northeast, like before, but it couldn't get any further, so it propagated along the eastern rim and then went out of the caldera. You can see it goes down out of the caldera and then comes up in this channel here and goes out into the dike and out into Holrinn, where it erupted at the end of the month. This is the first day. So I left out the events that were out there, but you can see they're color-coded according to time from 0 hours to 24. You can see that in the early hours, the earthquakes are propagating out of the caldera and they're going down. Probably they are preceding the magma. And then in the evening, it starts going up again underneath here. And here is the spectrogram again, like I showed you earlier. This is 18 hours from midnight till 6 o'clock. Here is where the swarm starts, really strong swarm. And the magma starts to try to exit here in the afternoon. So all this activity is when it's trying to get out of the caldera. And then finally, in the late hours, it gets there. So all this, I should have told you earlier, these vertical strikes, they represent earthquakes. They have a very short duration, so they come across as these many, many strikes. So this is continuous earthquakes, very strong. I cut it off here, they're much bigger than this. So the most energy was spent in breaking the path out of the caldera. And then I think it went, that's the next story. So then it goes along this dike, the propagating out to Holrinn. Here is a 3D version of it. It's color-coded with time, like in the previous one. And from the mapping, the high-precision mapping of these events, we can really show the details of this magma, this dike propagation. And that was reported in the Nature paper. I forgot to reference it here, that Kristín was heading. And so this is a highly accurate event. Sequence. Okay, I'm almost done. So this is the vertical channel underneath the southern part of the dike. I'm locating all events from 2008 to 2015, and I also include part of the dike here. It goes from 28 kilometers and all the way to the surface. I also, here on the right, I'm looking through the vertical cross-section from the south here and here from the east. And then again, I plotted where I have thrown out the worst located events so that the better located events are left. And we can see that there's these offset two channels with no activity here in the middle, where I think there is a magma pocket magma coming out of Bárðarbunga hit and allowed it to propagate out into Holhraun. So in summary, what have we learned from the recent eruptions? We learned that the onset of eruptions is not always preceded by strong earthquake swarms. They could have occurred earlier when the magma was coming up towards the surface. And fissure eruptions can be very sneaky. The AFL labeled eruption, we learned about it from a farmer that told us. Deep earthquakes are important to monitor the inflow of magma into the volcanoes, and they can provide long-term and also short-term early warnings of eruptions, like we saw. And the Bárðarbunga event was really a regional tectonic event. It generated so much seismicity over such a large region that all the way north to Askja and all around, that the noise from these other volcanoes was drowning out some more of the subtle signals that probably were associated with the fissure eruptions, but we had a really hard time seeing them. So I'm done. Thank you.